meaning of the word offence, as discussed in this video, has been defined in various ways. Something that provokes a sense of outrage, any violation of a social code, the act of causing anger, resentment, or displeasure, annoyance or resentment brought about by a perceived insult to or disregard for oneself. To offend is to hurt or wound the feelings of, to transgress, to be displeasing. These definitions make clear at the outset the subjective nature of offence. We can feel offended and experience negative emotions for all kinds of reasons, but it doesn't follow that the source of our resentment is worthy of blame, criticism, or attack. Nor does it follow that the reaction of taking offence is reasonable or justified. Dictators might feel outraged by the exposure of their hypocrisies. Young children might feel displeased about the boundaries set for them by adults. Narcissists might resent sharing the spotlight with others. In each case, negative emotions are felt, but there's no obligation to accommodate these wishes or demands. Merely feeling offended by another's words or actions isn't in itself evidence of suffering unreasonable harm. We know from the fact that people experience phobias that emotional reactions are sometimes irrational and extremely disproportionate. Sometimes people report being offended simply because their views have been challenged, even if those views are used to obstruct education or justify the mistreatment of others. Certainly, if we want to punish or restrict behavior we find objectionable, we need to be able to point to something more than our own hurt feelings to make a valid case. There are good reasons to limit certain kinds of abusive speech and action, and each limit or prohibition requires its own carefully reasoned justification. But sometimes, complaints about free speech infringement result from confusion about entitlements. If Abe writes a letter to a commercial magazine and the magazine doesn't publish it, this is not an attack on his free speech. The magazine's not silencing him by not printing his letter, and has no obligation to grant him a platform on its publication. We might despise the bias shown by some media companies, but unless they present themselves as a free speech forum, they have no duty to facilitate our speech. Abe would have a cause for grievance if he was prevented from self-publishing. The poet John Milton experienced this infringement when he attempted to publish a collection of pamphlets arguing for reform of the divorce laws. The licensing order of 1643 meant that all printed material had to be approved by the government. Failing to get permission for his pamphlets, Milton was inspired to write his famous defense of free speech, Areopagitica, arguing for reform of the print licensing laws. In 1914, nurse Margaret Sanger was indicted for violating obscenity laws. Her crime? She posted pamphlets containing educational information on contraception. Violating social codes can leave people feeling offended. But when social codes are discovered to be regressive, violating them can serve to highlight this and bring about positive change. When we avoid challenging social codes or customs because we fear causing offence, we can needlessly sacrifice a lot of time, energy, and emotion. Two parents raise 5 children strictly to follow a particular religion. As the children grow up, they all privately stop believing in that religion. But even after their parents are dead, they continue with acts of religious worship so as not to offend their siblings. Their collective silence about their real views keeps them in what's been called pluralistic ignorance. Steven Pinker describes how more extreme cases of pluralistic ignorance can take hold, how a collective delusion can overtake an entire society when unpopular views are censored or punished. If dissenters are punished and can anticipate they're going to be punished, then you might have a situation where no one actually believes something, but everyone believes that everyone else believes it. Therefore, no one is willing to be the little boy that says the emperor is naked. Writing in the mid-1800s, John Stuart Mill, in his book On Liberty, listed some contemporary cases of individuals being abused by the courts for declaring no theological belief. For this apparent offence, they were variously rejected as jury members, grossly insulted by a judge, and denied justice against a thief. Mill noted that the legal doctrine of disallowing evidence from atheists meant not only that they could be robbed or insulted with impunity, but that their testimony couldn't help theists who were robbed or assaulted. Furthermore, Mill noted that the rule cut away its own foundation. By assuming atheists to be liars, it allowed the testimony of any atheist willing to lie, and rejected the testimony of those who braved public contempt by truthfully affirming their atheism. The concept of offence has been exploited to perpetuate other social inequalities. For instance, the translation of religious scripture has been deemed offensive, both historically and in the present day, resulting in scriptural knowledge being withheld from the masses. In the 1500s, William Tyndale translated the Bible into English, believing people should be able to read scripture in their mother tongue. For this achievement, he was burned at the stake. Whether they spring from religious bodies, governments, or socio-political groups, there's no shortage of self-appointed authorities ready to control our freedoms as they see fit. But what qualifies them to do this? Who would you allow to decide what you see or hear? What ideas you can access? What books you can read? Which films you can watch? Whose opinions you can hear? Who would you nominate to dictate your opportunities for experience? One aspect of the culture at our secondary school was that students were expected to respond aggressively to insults, specifically insults to their families, especially their mothers. The insults didn't need to be that imaginative. Often, just the phrase, "your mum," was enough. In response, students were expected to get angry and physically defend their mother's honour. If they didn't, they were seen as weak and cowardly. This ritualised behaviour continued for a couple of years. Then, there was an interesting shift. Aggressive reactions to insults stopped being admired. Students who were easily provoked came to be seen as weak and fragile, and were scorned for being hysterical. Shrugging off insults became the cool thing to do. The frequency of insults didn't go down, but the frequency of aggressive responses plummeted. In groups where dramatic expressions of offence are encouraged and rewarded, we can make two predictions. First, we can expect to see more expressions of offence. Second, we can expect to see them in response to increasingly smaller provocation, as individuals hunt for things to act offended about. But when overblown reactions of offence receive scorn instead of sympathy, the emotional displays can fizzle out fast, exposing the fact that they're unnecessary and well within personal control. If teenagers can learn to control their responses like this, shouldn't we expect even more emotional maturity from adults? Reportedly inspired by Viktor Ivanov's "Lenin Lived, Lenin is Alive, Lenin Will Live" poster, a painting called "The Spear" by artist Brett Murray was put on exhibition at Johannesburg's Goodman Gallery in May 2012, portraying South African President Jacob Zuma in a state of indiscretion. A spokesperson for Zuma's party, the ANC, said they were of the view that this distasteful depiction of the president has violated his individual right to dignity, as contained in the constitution of our country. On this basis, the ANC initiated legal proceedings to censor the painting, including coercive attempts to stop the press circulating the image. But should the right to dignity be automatic here? Dignity is defined as the state or quality of being worthy of honour or respect. But political commentator Justice Malala noted, "There is nothing in our constitution that enjoins us to respect the head of state or to genuflect before him. This is a constitutional democracy, not a monarchy. Respect is earned, and very few would say that the president has earned our respect, given his lifestyle." The case against Murray failed, but satirists in China haven't been so fortunate. Shanghai-based artist Dai Jiangyong was faced with a 5-year prison sentence after distributing a picture of China's president, Xi Jinping, with an unfortunate facial expression and a photoshopped moustache. One student in Tianjin was reportedly detained for 10 days merely for downloading an unauthorized image of Xi. If we expect emotional stability and resilience from adults in power, an all-powerful, all-knowing being like a god should embody the highest expression of these qualities. But many of those who propose the existence of such beings characterize them and their supposed earthly representatives, the prophets, as the most fragile, insecure creatures who need protection from words and pictures. Dutch film director Theo van Gogh was murdered by a Muslim extremist after producing the short film Submission, which criticized the treatment of women in Islam. In 2005, Danish newspaper Jyllands-Posten published several cartoons depicting Muhammad. In response, violent Muslim protests around the world resulted in dozens of murders, as well as attacks against those associated with the newspapers that published the cartoons. In 2015, in response to the publication of cartoons of Muhammad by French satirical newspaper Charlie Hebdo, Muslim gunmen stormed the newspaper's Paris offices and killed 12 people. In each of these cases, on one side we find indisputable acts of harm, namely the violent attacks and murders committed by offended people. On the other, we find acts the harmful nature of which is fiercely disputed, namely the creation of text and images that challenge or ridicule ideas. And yet in all cases, many voices were focused only on condemning the text and images. For example, when Theo van Gogh was murdered, the then Dutch Minister for Justice proposed the enforcement of blasphemy legislation. These commentators had so abdicated their sense of proportion, rationality, and moral accountability that, for them, the text and images were the weightier issue. A 2006 Intelligence Squared debate asked whether freedom of expression should include the license to offend. After condemning the Danish cartoons and what she regarded as offensive criticism of religion, Muslim campaigner Daisy Khan said the following in her closing statement: "Only when you make the effort to understand the perspective of the other person can you begin to understand the rationale behind their actions and thoughts, and only then can you even begin to be critical." If Khan practiced what she preached, she would make the effort to understand the perspective of critics of religion, like the Danish cartoonists, to try and understand the rationale behind their actions and thoughts. By her own logic, only then would she be in the position to be critical. Khan asks that criticism be made in ways that don't offend the religious, failing to acknowledge that for many millions of people, any criticism of their religion whatsoever is deemed offensive. Sometimes, even the failure to take offense is deemed offensive. Liberal Democrat and secular Muslim Majid Nawaz has attempted to promote the fact that not all Muslims take offense at cartoons of Muhammad. In 2014, he tweeted a cartoon from a British webcomic called Jesus and Mo, depicting Jesus saying "Hey," and Mo saying "How you doing?" and stated that he didn't find the cartoon offensive. In response, he was condemned and threatened for his lack of offense. Fellow Lib Dem Muslim Mohammed Shafiq called Nawaz a defamer of the Prophet, a charge known to carry a death penalty in the Islamic world, and vowed to notify national and international Islamic organizations. Responses from others included the threat of a surprise when Nawaz next visited Pakistan. Shafiq further organized a petition pressing for Nawaz's deselection from the Lib Dems, claiming he'd caused an extreme amount of insult, hurt, and anguish. This tactic is called second-order punishment. Here, the individual isn't punished for causing offense, but refusing to condemn others for causing offense, or simply for not expressing offense themselves. This tactic is used in dictatorships and high-control groups. Another example of it is seen with Scientologists and Jehovah's Witnesses, when ex-members are shunned by the entire group. Those who've refused to shun an ex-member have found themselves in the firing line. In an ABC 2020 report called Scientology: A War Without Guns, Dan Harris asked Scientology representative Monique Yingling if shunning was voluntary. She said it was always voluntary. But when pressed, she admitted that those who don't shun may not be able to participate in specific services. So, there are negative consequences for refusing to shun ex-members. Modern examples of social isolation tactics include the intimidation of critics of various religious or political ideologies by targeting their place of employment. In Mill's On Liberty, he promotes three forms of basic liberty. 1. The liberty to unite for any purpose not involving harm to others. Here, Mill emphasizes the need for free, informed, age-appropriate consent. 2. Liberty of tastes and pursuits, which Mill suggests we should enjoy without impediment from our fellow creatures, so long as what we do does not harm them, even though they should think our conduct foolish, perverse, or wrong. 3. Liberty of thought and feeling. Absolute freedom of opinion and sentiment on all subjects, practical or speculative, scientific, moral, or theological. For Mill, practically inseparable from this was the liberty of expressing and publishing opinions, but he made an exception in the case of what we might call incitement. Mill writes, "An opinion that corn dealers are starvers of the poor or that private property is robbery ought to be unmolested when simply circulated through the press, but may justly incur punishment when delivered orally to an excited mob assembled before the house of a corn dealer." For some, inciting a mob to riot is an unambiguous act of harm. But for Thomas Scanlon, things aren't so clear-cut. He points out that when an individual hears the inciter's opinion, it becomes subject to that individual's own judgment. The individual isn't merely a mindless machine set in motion by the inciter. Individuals have personal responsibility for their own actions. Scanlon contrasts the inciter's act of merely expressing an opinion with the act of a criminal accomplice, an agent who provides others with tools to facilitate a crime, like the key to a bank, or technical information, like the combination to a safe. He also distinguishes inciters from those who threaten and intimidate people into performing harmful acts. Of course, some inciters do more than merely express an opinion. Some actively groom their audience, cultivating compliance to the group by rewarding agreement, punishing dissent, and maintaining ignorance. By bringing in the element of undue influence, and thereby exerting greater power, they take on greater responsibility for any resulting harm. When proposing limits on free speech, we need to exercise caution. There are good reasons for protecting controversial viewpoints. Hearing opposing views gives us the opportunity to examine why we disagree with them, to reflect, from first principles, the reasons for our views. If we can't express the reasons for our objections, then the act of objecting is merely expressing mindless, reflex disapproval, regurgitating a pap of pre-digested opinion formulated by others who are possibly misguided. When we object to another person's views purely instinctively, we might be correct. But it's when we can articulate the reasons behind the instinct that we can better assess its rightness or wrongness. It's not just the right of the person who speaks to be heard, explains Christopher Hitchens, summarizing sentiments expressed by John Milton, Thomas Paine, and John Stuart Mill. It is the right of everyone in the audience to listen and to hear. And every time you silence someone, you make yourself a prisoner of your own action because you deny yourself the right to hear something. In other words, your own right to hear and be exposed is as much involved in all these cases as is the right of the other to voice his or her view. If all in society were agreed on the truth and beauty and value of one proposition, all except one person, it would be most important, in fact it would become even more important, that one heretic be heard, because we would still benefit from his perhaps outrageous or appalling view. Hitchens warns, "Don't take refuge in the false security of consensus and feeling that whatever you think you're bound to be okay because you're in the safely moral majority. No one has the right not to be offended. Such a right would be impossible to exercise and result in social gridlock. Some regard the mere existence of other kinds of people as offensive. How could we satisfy them, short of eliminating those other people? Learning to deal with the discomfort of encountering people you disagree with is part of the process of growing up. Some feel offended by facts that don't fit their ideology. In these cases, their argument isn't with other people, but with reality." When we try to silence expressions we deem offensive, we often give them more power. When books, films, or pieces of music have been banned, it's often because certain ideologies have found them dangerous. In many cases, the dangerous idea has been to allow people to think. Banning also fuels curiosity. When scholars are prevented from speaking at universities because people dislike what they say, this usually results in far more publicity for the scholar, whose visit might otherwise pass without much attention. When we allow controversial books, films, music, and speakers, we can openly examine and discuss them, possibly exposing their flaws, but retaining the opportunity to think and increase our understanding. Those who don't want to hear a message they personally find offensive can choose not to listen. But what they have no right to do is impose their choices upon others by preventing them from listening. Sometimes, dialoguing with parties we've judged as offensive can lead to surprising results. Talking with extreme candor about her experiences interviewing leaders and followers of the men's rights movement, formerly self-defined feminist filmmaker Cassie J has described how her pre-existing views of the movement prevented her from listening to what her interviewees were saying. J reflected, "In those moments, sitting across from my enemy, I wasn't listening. I was waiting to hear a sentence, or even just a couple of words in succession, that proved what I wanted to believe. I would often hear an innocent and valid point that a men's rights activist would make. But in my head, I would add on to their statement a sexist or anti-woman spin, assuming that's what they wanted to say, but didn't." Jay cited an instance where a men's rights activist asked, "Where is justice for the man who was falsely accused of raping a woman and is branded with the inescapable title of rapist?" Jay said she heard, "A woman being raped isn't a big deal." Over time, she realized many offensive attitudes she'd previously attributed to her enemy group were false. Listening to parties we've judged as offensive can give us a valuable opportunity to find out we're the misinformed party that needs to rethink some opinions we've misguidedly accepted. John Stuart Mill wrote that the peculiar evil of silencing the expression of an opinion is that it is robbing the human race, posterity, as well as the existing generation, those who dissent from the opinion, still more than those who hold it. If the opinion is right, they are deprived of the opportunity of exchanging error for truth. If wrong, they lose what is almost as great a benefit, the clearer perception and livelier impression of truth produced by its collision with error. Offense can have positive or negative value depending on circumstances. On the positive side, it can be a tool for resisting tyranny and a lubricant for social progress. It can expose difficult truths and prompt us to usefully examine and possibly reassess our values. On the negative side, the concept of offense can be exploited to shut down discourse and thought, to stigmatize and denounce critics, to generate and justify violent revenge, to protect bogus and harmful ideologies, to strip us of our fundamental freedoms. Offense does not legitimize violence. Hurt feelings by themselves are no reason to limit free expression. We stand to gain much from learning to cope with offense rather than attempting to banish it. We stand to gain much from learning to appreciate the value of offense.